The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, 13th chapter, text number 1 through 2, given at the Uppsala University by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded on September 7th, 1973, in Stockholm, Sweden.
So I shall try to discuss Bhagavad Gita, 13th chapter, in which nature, the enjoyer and consciousness is described. Sri Arjuna Vata. Arjuna belongs to the royal family of the Pandavas, and he was friend of Krishna. So there was a fight between two groups of cousin brothers, the Kauravas and the Pandavas. So Krishna was requested by both the parties to join either of them. But Krishna decided not to take part in the fighting because both of them were equally related to him. So after all, Krishna divided his soldiers one side and himself another side with the condition that if he joins, then he would not fight. So Arjuna preferred to take Krishna on his side, and the other party, Duryodhana, he decided to take Krishna's soldiers. So while just the fighting was to begin, Arjuna declined to fight because the other party were all his relatives, friends, brothers, brother, son, nephew, teacher and grandfather. So Arjuna took compassion that I don't want victory, better not to fight. So that is the cause of describing the science of Bhagavad Gita before Arjuna, just to induce him to act as a dutiful soldier. This is the background of Bhagavad Gita. So there are many questions and answers. There are 700 verses. So we shall discuss this evening about the nature, the enjoyer and the consciousness. Sri Arjuna Vacha, Prakritim Purusam Chaiva Kshetram Kshetramaya Vacha Etat Veditam Ichyami Jnanam Jnanam Chakesa. Those who have got this copy, it is page 690. Arjuna wanted to know Prakriti, the nature, the material nature, and Purusham. Purusham means the enjoyer, the living entity. Here, in this material world, every living entity is trying to enjoy this material. Prakritim Purusham Chaiva Kshetram. Kshetram means field of activity. And Kshetravya means the knower of the field. Just like in agricultural field, the field is there and the cultivator is there. The cultivator knows that it is my field of activity. So he is to be supposed as Kshetravya, one who knows about his field of activities. Etat Veditam Ichyami. Because Krishna has been accepted as a teacher. First of all, Krishna and Arjuna were talking as friends. But when Arjuna saw it, that friendly talking will not make any solution of the problem. So at that time, he surrendered to Krishna that I become your disciple. Sishyastyaham sadhimam prapannam. And I surrender unto you. That is the relationship between teacher and the student. The student must receive knowledge submissively, not by challenge. Therefore, one has to select a teacher where one can submit. That is the process. Tadvidhi panipatena pariprasnena sevaya. Teacher must be approached with submission. Tadvidhi panipatena. Panipat means submission. And pariprasnena. Then question. And seva and service also. These three things are the basic principle of receiving knowledge. So submission means I must approach somebody who is actually in better position or higher position. Otherwise, what is the use of approach? Tadvidhi panipatena pariprasnena sevaya. And seva means service. You cannot challenge. You approach such person whose instruction you shall receive. You can inquire submissively, but you cannot challenge. That is not allowed in Vedic system. Samitpani sutriyam brahmanishtam. Therefore, before selecting a teacher, you must decide whether you can submit there. If you cannot submit there, don't approach, don't waste time. So, that is the process. And Arjuna submitted to Arjuna, Krishna. So there are many questions. Here is another question. Krishna, I want to know the material nature and the living entities who are trying to enjoy the resources of this material nature. This whole world, every living entity, even birds and beasts, they are also trying to lord it over the material nature. What to speak of human being, they are trying to overcome the stringent laws of material nature by so many scientific improvements, but still they are under material nature. That is the conclusion of Bhagavad Gita. Devi jesa gunamai mama maya durutpaya. This material nature is called maya, energy. Actually it is the energy. Energy of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. From Vedic literature we get information. God has got many potencies or energies. Prasasakti dvidhaiva sriyate, sabhaviki jnana balapyacha, natasya karjam karanancha vidyate, natasya sama adhikasya drishyate. These are the basic information. God means natasya karjam karanancha vidyate. He has nothing to do. He has simply to desire. I think in your Christian Bible also it is said, God said, let there be creation, and there was creation. He has to simply desire. Other things will be done by his energies. Just like big man, a king or president, he simply sends an order, this must be done. The things will be done by the subordinates. He has got so many energies, secretaries. So why not for God, the Supreme Being, God? So therefore, the basic instruction is, God has nothing to do, practically. Simply his desire is sufficient. Natasya karjam karanam cha vidyate, natasya sama udikasya drishyate. There is nobody equal to him or above him. Everyone must be below, subordinate. That is Vedic instruction. And that has been selected, or that has been concluded, who is that supreme being. That is, we also get from Vedic information, Ishvara Parama Krishna. The supreme being means Krishna. The Krishna, the word means all attract. Therefore he is supreme. God must be all attractive. It is not that God is attractive for the Hindus or God is attractive for the Muslims or the Christians. No. If he is God at all, then he must be attractive for all. That is the meaning of the word Krishna. All attract. So this is a very nice word. Actually, God has no name, but we call him by different holy names according to his activity. Just like we believe that God is great. So this is fact. The Vedic instruction is also there. Natasya sama adhikasta dishyate. Nobody is equal, nobody is greater than him. Therefore God is great. Now who is that God? Great. That is decided. Ishvara Parama Krishna. Krishna is the supreme being. Ishvara Parama Krishna. Ishvara means control. That is the exact equivalent for the word God. God means controller, supreme controller. So that supreme controller means he has nobody else to control him. Here in this material world or anywhere, we find one controller. He is controlling, but he is also being controlled. He is not absolute control. Here we find some, say, president. He is controlling the state, but he is also being controlled by popular votes. If the popular votes are against him, he cannot control anymore. So here you just analyze anyone. He may be controller, but at the same time he is controlled. Not that absolute control. Nobody can find. So if in this way you go on searching out where a person is not only controller, but he is not controlled by anyone, that is God. This is the simple definition of God. God controls everyone or everything, but he is not controlled by anyone. That is God. Ishvara Parama Krishna, Satchidananda Vigraha, and he has got form. He is a person. He is not impersonal. Because as soon as you speak of controller, it cannot be impersonal. Controller must be a person. He must have brain, he must have desire, he must have capacity to give order, and so many things. So, therefore, the basic information is the supreme, absolute truth is a person. He is not impersonal. The impersonal realization of God is realization of his different potencies. It's like this material world. This is the manifestation of one of the potencies of God. He has got many potencies, so all the many potencies have been grouped into three. The material potency, the spiritual potency, and the marginal potency between the material and spiritual. the spiritual potency, we can understand that I am speaking. I am speaking means I am spiritual being. I am speaking. This material body is my covering, just like shirt and coat. So, now I am existing, somehow or other, I have been encased in this material body, but I am spirit soul. That is spiritual potential. And as this material world is made of material ingredients, similarly, there is another world that information we can get from Bhagavad Gita. Parastasmat bhava anya bhaktya bhaktya sanatana. There is another nature, another manifestation of nature. That is spiritual. What is the distinction? The distinction is when this material world will be annihilated, that will remain. Just like I am spirit soul, when this body is annihilated, I am not annihilated. Na hannate hannamane sarire. After the destruction of this body, the soul is not destroyed. Soul remains there in the subtle body, mind, intelligence and ego. So that mind, intelligence and ego, that carries him to another gross body. That is called transmigration of the soul. This gross body, this body, but even in our experience during this lifetime, we have experienced so many gross bodies came and went out. Just like I was a child, I possessed one gross body, child's body, that came and gone away. I had a boy's body that came and gone away. A young man's body I had, but that came and gone away. Similarly, this body, old man's body, it has come and it will also go. In spite of so many other bodies came and went, similarly, when this body will no longer exist, I'll transfer myself or transmigrate into another gross body. This is called transmigration of the soul. Krishna, about Krishna it is said that he is the supreme controller and he has got his form, his body, which is not made of these material ingredients. Satchit Ananda Vigraha. Vigraha means body. So he has got body. But what kind of body? Satchit Ananda. It is the ingredients are spiritual, not material. Here the ingredients, God's body, I have got, you have got. Earth, water, air, fire, mind, intelligence, ego, these ingredients. But Krishna's body, the ingredients are Sat, Chit, Ananda. Sat means eternity. Chit means knowledge. And Ananda means blissfulness. That is his body. Satchidananda Vigraha, but he has got a body, he has got a form, transcendental form. Satchidananda Vigraha, anadi. Anadi means because nobody is controller above him. Therefore, he is the supreme controller. He has no beginning. Anadi, adi, and he is the beginning of everything. Anadi, adi, Govinda. His name is Govinda. Krishna, Govinda, there are many names. There are millions of names of God. We are just mentioning one or two. So, anadi adi Govinda, sarva karana karana. The cause of all causes. Everything has got cause and effect. So, therefore, Arjuna has decided to take knowledge from Krishna, the supreme being. and he has no material body. Therefore, his knowledge, whatever knowledge is given by Krishna, that is perfect. Anyone who is giving knowledge in this material body, he has got four defects. The first defect is that a person in the material body must commit mistake. Must commit. Less or more. And anyone who possessing this material body, he must be illusion. Illusion means that accepting something for something. Just like we are accepting this body as self. But this is illusion. I am not this body. I am spiritual, spark, part and parcel of God. That is my position. But anyone identifying himself, he thinks that he is this body, especially the animals. The animals have no knowledge that is different from knowledge, the body. Therefore, a human being, if he is under the impression that he is this body, he is no better than the animal. Therefore, in the human form of life, one can understand his real identity. He can understand what is God. He can understand what is relationship with God and act accordingly. If he does so, then his human life is perfect. Otherwise, he remains like animal and he gets no benefit by this nature's gift, human form of life. By evolutionary process, we come to the human form of life, passing through 8 million, about 8,300,000 species of life. Then we come to this form of life, civilized human being. So this should not be misused in the business of cats and dogs. This should be used for better purposes. The better purpose is to understand oneself, what he is actually, whether he is this body, whether he is this mind, or whether he is different from body and mind, a spiritual spark. That is real knowledge. So, Krishna is delivering this knowledge in the Bhagavad Gita, and Arjuna is receiving the beginning of his instruction was that dehinasmin yatha dehi kaumaram jauvanam jara tatha dehantara prapti dhirasattva namayati. Krishna first began this lesson. My dear Arjuna, you are not this body. Why you are lamenting about this body? You are not this body. Neither your so-called relatives, they are this body. They are different. Asmin dehe, in this body, there is the proprietor of the body, the dehi. Just like you are not the coat and shawl, you are the proprietor of the coat and shawl. Similarly, this body is also covering the subtle body and the gross body, coat and shawl. But we are different from this coat and shawl. That is the beginning of the instruction. It is going on. And again, Arjuna is asking that prakitiṁ puruṣaṁ caiva cetaṁ cetragvam eva ca etat veditum icchāmi. He stood and, my Lord Krishna, I want to understand what is this material nature prakitiṁ puruṣaṁ means enjoyer and prakiti means enjoyed. Just like we have got little conception, male and female. So prakriti means the female, the object of enjoyment. And purusha means the enjoyer. So here, although you are dressed in a different way, male or female, everyone is trying to enjoy. Therefore, even a woman is dressed like woman, his feature is woman's body. Actually, she is trying to enjoy, therefore she is purusha. Purusha means enjoy. So here in this material world, either male or female, it doesn't matter. Everyone is trying to enjoy. Therefore he is called Purusha. Or the living entity is called Purusha. So Arjuna's inquiry is, what is this prakriti? Everyone is trying to. Now, yesterday we had lecture in the university. Technology. The one technology is question. The technology means the process by which we can enjoy this material world. That is technology. So the spirit is how to enjoy. So prakritim purusham caiva and kshetram. Kshetram means the field of activities. Although everyone is trying to enjoy, but he cannot enjoy according to his wings. He is limited with the body. A man is trying to enjoy, and a cat and dog is also trying to enjoy. But the enjoyment of the cats and dogs are different from the man's enjoyment because on account of different body. The facility of enjoyment has been given by nature according to different body. Therefore we find intelligent man and less intelligent man, cats and dogs and human beings, and different types of men, different types of plants, different types of animals, varieties, 8,400,000. The nature is so acute. As you try to enjoy this material world, he'll give you a suitable type of body. Just like a pig. A pig means he has no discrimination of food. He can eat even stew. So similarly, persons who have no discrimination, what kind of food we should eat. So, he is given the next chance to become a pig, so that there will be no discrimination. And he has got a particular type of body, a particular type of mouth, so that he can enjoy any abominable things. A tiger wants to suck fresh blood, so nature has given a suitable type of body with jaws and nails, so that he can immediately attack an animal and suck the blood. So in this way, prakite kriyamanani gunai karmani sarvas. We are trying to enjoy, but we have got different desires of enjoyment. So every particular thing is taken into account by the laws of nature. And the next life, because if I try for something, I am absorbed in that thought, and at the time of my death, when I leave this gross body, my mental condition is there, and that mental condition carries me to a suitable position where I get a suitable body to fulfill the mental desires. This is the process of transmigration. So, our process is, this is also described in the Bhagavad Gita. Janti deva brata devan, pitrin janti pitrin brataha, bhuteja janti bhutani, madhyajinopi janti ma. There are many who worship demigods. So they will go to the planet where demigods reside. There are innumerable planets. This, according to Vedic literature, this moon planet is also the place where demigods reside. The sun planet also like that, and many other planets. The Bhagavad Gita says, Janti deva brata deva. If you want to go to the moon planet, sun planet, Venus planet, or any other planet, you just prepare yourself in this life. And at the time of death, you will transfer to such and such condition of life. Similarly, Pitri Prata, There are Pitri Lokas, Bhuteja. Bhuteja and Ghost Varsipa. They will also go to such planet. And Madhajaji no ki janti ma. Krishna says, those who want to go to me, back to home, back to Godhead, they can also go there. They can also go there. Therefore, our this Krishna consciousness movement is that if I have to prepare myself in this life, actually, this life is preparation for the next life. That is a fact. So, here is a chance, this human form of life. Either you go back to home, back to Godhead, or again you go to the cycle of a different species of life, bhutta bhutta praliyate. You accept one type of body, live there for some time, then give it up, then accept another type of body, live for some time, then accept another type of body. In this way, but we are so much illusion that although this is botheration to accept one type of body, again give it up, again accept another type of body, we are not disgusted with this business. Because actually we are eternal. Why should we accept one type of body, live there for some time, and again change it? That we have experienced. Just like anyone of us would desire that my youthful body may remain. We try to keep that youthfulness like so many medicine, like so many means. But nature will not allow to keep yourself always youthful. That is not possible. You must change. Therefore, one should be inquisitive that I don't want this type of body, this old body, feeble body, more conditioned, with rheumatic disease and other so many, this is tough disease. I don't want it, but I am forced to accept this one. This is real problem. I don't want to die, but death is forced upon me. So these postures should be raised by really advanced human beings. That I don't want all these things. I want to enjoy this material world. But I am forced to change into a body I cannot enjoy. I cannot enjoy. This is real problem. That real problem has been discussed in the Bhagavad Gita. Janma mittu jarabhyadi dukkho doshanu darshanam. We want to enjoy. But suppose I am a technologist. I want to enjoy this material world. I manufacture something very good facility for living condition, as you are doing. But before finishing my desirable construction, nature takes me out. Just like I saw in France, Paris. What is that arch? Yes. Napoleon wanted to construct that arch. He was so, powerful man. But he could not see the arch beginning in his life, Western. He did not like that. He wanted to see something more. But he was taken. But we are not seeing this point. That I am trying to enjoy, and we are adopting so many means, but where is the certainty of my enjoyment? At any moment I shall be kicked out. Get out. That brain is lacking in the present civilization. Therefore, it is said in the Bhagavatam, because these persons are abodha, have no full knowledge, therefore they are trying for something to enjoy, which may not be allowed to him. It is not actually allowed to him. Nobody wants to die. He wants to enjoy, live here. But that is not possible. This is the real problem, that we have accepted a condition of life in the material world, which will not allow me to fulfill my desires to the fullest extent. That is the real problem. And that is explained in the Bhagavad Gita. Janma mrityu jarabhyadhi dukkha dushan. Those who are actually thoughtful, these would know these four principles of problem or unhappiness always in front. He should think that I am trying to enjoy, I am planning to enjoy this material world, but I have to die, I have to give up this body at any moment. There is no guarantee that I shall live so many years. There is no guarantee at any moment. Therefore, the death has been described by Krishna, mrityu sarva harascha aham. Mrityu means death, and sarva harascha means one who takes away everything. Sarva harascha. That is I am, Krishna says, or God says. Those who are demons, those who cannot see God or feel the presence of God, they are called demons. So sometimes we hear, they say, can you show me God? Well, God is everywhere. God is within our heart. Annantarastham paramanuchayantarastham. God is within this universe. God is within your heart. God is within the atom also. Now you have to make your eyes to see. And why do you say, can you show me God? Have you got the eyes to see? Your eyes are imperfect. Why you are so much proud of your eyes? If there is no light, you cannot see. So what is the value of your eyes? So your seeing power is under certain condition. Therefore, if you want to see God, then you have to fulfill the condition. That condition is given in the Vedic literature. Premanjana churita bhakti vilochanena santa sadaiva ridayesu vilopayan yam shama sundara machinta gunasarupam govinda madipurusam tamaham bhaja. If you have to see God, then you have to apply the ointment of love of God in your eyes. And then your eyes will be clean, and you will see God. This is God. Prema anjana. Prema means love of God. And anjana means ointment. Just like sometimes we do not see correctly. In India there is a kind of powder called surma. They apply it and they see clearly. Or some any other. Similarly, there is possibility of seeing God with these eyes, provided you cleanse it. And what is the cleansing process? Love of God. That's all. If you actually learn how to love God, that is practical. If you love somebody, in spite of being engaged in so many other occupations, you see your lover always. When shall I meet? When shall I talk with him? Or with her? This is practical. So, if it is materially possible, if you develop your loving tendency, you have got the loving tendency. That is natural. Because living being is part and parcel of God. God is loving. So we have got that propensity of love. But our loving propensity has turned into lust at the present moment due to material conditions. See, if you want to purify that lust tendency into love, then we can see God. That is the condition. That you have to learn. That is called bhakti yogam. Bhakti yogam, which we are teaching, Krishna consciousness. The human life is meant for understanding God, for seeing God, for talking with God, for behaving with God. That is possible. But it requires little training from the animalistic life, the animal cannot talk of God, cannot understand of God, cannot see God. But if we remain in the animalistic way of life, then it is not possible to see God and talk with Him. But if we purify ourselves, if we apply the ointment of love of God on the eye, then premanyana churita bhakti vilala chanena santa, those who are saints, I think this saint word has come from the Sanskrit word, santa. Santa is Sanskrit word. Santa sadaiva ridayesu vilopayanti. Those who are saintly persons, those who have trained themselves in the affairs of love of Godhead, they can see God constantly within the heart. That is possible. So here, Arjuna is also a saintly person. He is not ordinary man, because he is talking with Krishna personally. If Arjuna has got the chance of making friendship with God and talking with Him personally, everyone has got the same capacity, provided we elevate ourselves to that standard of life, bhakti, bhakti yoga. It is stated in the Bhagavad Gita. If anyone wants to understand me, then the process is bhakti, devotional service. The process means how to love God, that process. And in the Bhagavatam it is said, what is first class religion? Savai punsan paro dharma jato bhakti adhokhati. That religion is first class, which makes the follower a lover of God. This is simple definition of religion, first class religion. If we do not act our dormant love for God, then samai bhakti, then you follow any type of religion, you are simply wasting your time. That's all. That is not religion. Religion means to understand God and to learn how to love God. So here, Arjuna, he loves Krishna, he is a lover of God. Therefore, he is asking questions from Krishna. But whatever question is answered by Krishna, that is perfect. Because he is perfect. So our process of receiving knowledge from the perfect, not one who is innocent, who commits mistake, whose senses are imperfect and wants to cheat. Because how an imperfect person can take the position of a teacher, if he has so many scientists, we ask so many things and they simply reply that yes, we are trying in future. That means he is not yet perfect. So if you are not perfect, why you are taking the position of a teacher? First of all, you will be perfect. So that is not possible. Therefore, our process of receiving knowledge is from the perfect. And who can be more perfect than God Himself? That is our process of knowledge. So Arjuna is asking from the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and the answer, the next verse is, Sri Bhagavan Uvaja. It is not said, Krishna Uvaja. It is said, Sri Bhagavan Uvaja. The Supreme Personality of Godhead replied. What is that? Idam sariram kaunteya chitram iti abhidhiyate. Etatja abhidhiti tang prahu chitragya iti tad vidha. He replied the answer very nicely, that this body is the field of activity. Idam sariram. Sariram means this body. This body is the field of activity. Idam sariram chetram konteya etatja vetti tang prahu chetragya iti tad vidha. And the person who knows this field of activity, just like if we meditate upon this body, if I see my finger, if I ask, what is this? This is my finger. What is this? This is my head. What is this? This is my leg. Everything mine. And where is the eye? Where is the eye? The eye means who is questioning. That is the eye. This is self-realization. Therefore, I, the real I, the soul, is different from this body. He's given the chance of living a certain type of body. Just like a man is given chance to work under certain office or position. Similarly, there are 8,400,000 forms of body, and each living entity has been given the chance to utilize it according to his desire. But because God is within you, everyone. Ishvara sarva bhutanam riddeshi arjuna tishtati. In the previous class also I recited, premanjana churita bhakti vilochanena santa sadaiva ridayeshu vilapayanti. He sees God present in his heart. So because God is there in everyone's heart, He's there. He's simply waiting for the chance when you are coming back to Him. He's so nice, so friendly. Because we have wanted to enjoy this material world. He's giving us the chance. All right, enjoy. Enjoy. I want to enjoy this world as a tiger. All right, take this body. I want to enjoy this world as a pig. All right, take it. I want to enjoy this life as Brahma, Lord Brahma, who has got millions and millions of years of age. All right, become Brahma. But Krishna advises, Abrahma bhuvana lokan punaravartino. My dear John, even if you go to the highest planetary system, the Brahma loka, again you have to come back. This is the position of material world. You accept this, and again, you accept another thing according to your karma. Just like you have got this human form of body, it is a great opportunity. But if you do not utilize as human being, if you utilize it as cats and dogs, again I am going to utilize it. This is the process. Vidam Chetram, this body, is the field of my activities. And I, the proprietor of the body, I am the knower of the body. Idam sariram chetam. Pontya chetam ete vidhiyate. Etajya betti. This is real knowledge. Etajya betti. That is knowledge. The knowledge of technology is not knowledge. That is ignorance. The knowledge of self-realization is actual knowledge. That is possible in this human form of life. That is not possible by the cats and dogs. If you misuse this body for the propensities like cats and dogs, you are misusing. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
You mean the relation between the Bhagavad Gita and the Vedic books?
Vedic knowledge means to understand God. The whole Vedic knowledge means we are getting, Veda means knowledge. Vetti Veda Vida Jnani. Veda means knowledge. So, we want to know so many things, that is knowledge. So you get all information from the Vedas. There is called Ayur Veda, Dhanur Veda, Yajur Veda. Veda means knowledge. But actually, the Veda means ultimately, to know God. That is called Vedanta. Anta means ultimate. And Veda means knowledge. So, ultimate knowledge is, when you know so many things, you have got so many subject matter for understanding. But, ultimately, when you understand what is God, that is the end of knowledge. That is the end of knowledge. So that is Vedanta. So Vedanta means to know the absolute truth, God. That is explained in the Bhagavad Gita. Vedaishta sarvai ahameva vedam vedanta git vedanta kritcha aham. Krishna said that by all Vedic knowledge, ultimately one must come to the point of knowing God. Therefore, another name of God is Brahma, Parabrahma. So Brahmana. Brahmana means one who knows Brahma. That is called Brahma. A Brahmana is not a class which is to be found in India only. No. Anyone who knows God, who knows the Parabrahma, he is Brahmana. Brahma janati iti Brahma. So Vedic knowledge means ultimately to become a Brahman. That means to know God. That is Vedic knowledge. And the summary, the Vedic knowledge is here in the Bhagavad Gita, because here God directly is instructing about Himself. Therefore it is the essence of all Vedic knowledge. The ultimate goal of Vedic knowledge is to know God. But we cannot know God. We have blind senses. Atha Sri Krishna Namadi Navhavet Grayam Indriyai. With these material senses, blind senses, imperfect senses, we cannot understand God. That is not possible. But if we can please God by our service, by our love, He reveals Himself. Revelation. That is the process. So simply by our speculation, and research why, we cannot find out God. That is not possible. Although God is here, everyone's heart. Sarvasya chaham vidhisannivishta. God is there, in everyone's heart. But who knows that? So there is a process by which one has to learn God. What is God? That is, srevanmukhihi jivhado samaiva spurattata. It is very peculiar process that you have to learn God through the tongue. Through the tongue. They want to see God with the eyes, but the basic information is that you have to know God through the tongue. Sevan mukhihi jiva. Jiva means tongue. When you employ your tongue in the service of the Lord, then He becomes the being. The tongue business is to glorify the Lord, chant the holy name of God. That is specially recommended in this age. You cannot follow all the rituals in any scripture. That is very difficult. We are so now fallen. It is not possible. Therefore, the general regulation is that you chant the holy name of the Lord. It does not mean that we are requesting you to chant the name of Krishna. We believe that Krishna is the name of God. But if you have got another name, God has many names. God is unlimited, therefore He has got unlimited names. So, if you chant that holy name of God, it doesn't matter. If it actually meaning, just like water. Water, if somebody says jaw, then he means water. If somebody says water, he means water. If somebody says pani, he means water. So actually, if the word you use as the name of God, if it's actually real name of God, then by chanting that holy name, you realize God. Therefore, tongue is the beginning of realization. Sevan mukhihi jibhava. As well as controlling the tongue. We have to spiritualize the tongue. If you keep the tongue materialized, then it is defective. So two things are done by the tongue. Tasting foodstuff and chanting the glories of the Lord. If we engage our tongue in this way, foodstuff means our process is to offer foodstuff to the Lord and the remnants of foodstuff we eat. Prasada. So, this is one process. This is one business of the tongue. And another business of the tongue is to chant the holy name of the Lord. So in this way, if you engage your tongue in the service of the Lord, then gradually you realize, you cannot realize, but God reveals Himself what He is. So Vedic knowledge means to realize God. That is the ultimate aim of Vedic knowledge. And here Bhagavad Gita is revealing Himself to Arjuna, because he is a devotee. So if we take the words of Arjuna, then he also realizes God. This is the problem.
I want to put a question about the relation between Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead and Paramatman and Brahman.
Brahma.
Which Brahman?
Yeah.
Brahman.
Yeah.
Which is the relation between these concepts? There are, according your commentaries to Bhagavad Gita, different. But what we
it is not different. Brahma, Paramatma, and Bhagavan. The absolute truth is one, but he is realized by different persons differently. Just like there is a big hill. So from very distant place you see that hill just like something like cloud. But if you go forward, then you see something green. And if you go actually to the hill, you see there are so many trees, so many houses, so many living entities. The object is the same, but realization from different angle of vision is different. That is the description of Srimad Bhagavatam. The absolute truth is called tattva. Vadanti tat tattvavidas tattvam yad jnanam advayam. When I see the hill as a cloud, it is the same hill. When I see the hill as something green, that is the same hill. And when I see the hill, actually it is functioning. There are so many trees, so many animals, so many men, so many houses. The same hill. Similarly, a Brahma, Paramatma and Bhagavan is the same thing, but it appears different according to persons' different realizations. But ultimately, the absolute truth is Bhagavan, Supreme Personality of Godhead.
What is this personality? It is not the same as our personality.
But that I want to say that he is different.
In which meaning use the concept of personality?
His person, that is stated in Bhagavad Gita in the second chapter, he said, "My dear Arjuna, I, you, and all these persons who are assembled, it is not that we are not existing in the past. It is not that we shall not exist in the future." When he says, "I, you, and all these persons," they are all persons. God is also person. Arjuna is also person. And all others who assemble in the battlefield, they are also persons. So Krishna says, all these persons, they are existing in the past. Now they are existing. And in future they will exist. So there is past, present and future. In no time, God is impersonal. Neither we are impersonal. We are also personal. And that is also confirmed. Nitya nityanam chetanas chetananam eka jo bahunam vidudhati kaman kathopanish. That he is the chief person amongst other persons. We living entities, we are many persons. And God is the chief person. And what is the difference between this person and that person, the singular number person one, and the plural number person many? And that is explained. Eka jo bahunam vidudhati kaman, that one singular number person is supplying all the necessities of these different plural number persons. That is the distinction. These things are expressed in Upanishad. So ultimately God is first.
When Upanishad
impersonal description.
The unity is unexpressible. It is
unexpressible.
Nothing can be said about.
No, why not? Why not? They just like this is also Upanishad. Nitya nitya naam chetana chetana naam. So he is a person. Ishavasamidam sam. There are so many. Apani pado jabana grhita. So oikhata. So asyata. So when there's in Christian Bible also they believe God creator. So if he is a creator, he must be a person.